What I want is for the humans in the forest to live in peace!
What I love about Ashitaka is he's not afraid to fight when he has to, but he will always look for the other way. He never does it with hate, and it's always exactly what is necessary. You can lay down arms really fast if it's not about revenge.
To see with eyes unclouded by hate.
We see the world through our own lenses. In conflict, everyone's behavior makes sense to them. Why did they do all these terrible things? To protect themselves.
This is what hatred looks like. This is what it does when it catches hold of you.
We all want to feel safe, respected, and loved. And a lot of our worst behaviors come from not feeling safe, respected, and loved.
The poisonous version of that is it turns into hate.
Yeah.
We all just kind of get a little bit better. Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. My name is Alan Seawright. I'm a professional filmmaker who needs therapy. I'm joined by my co-host,
Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves movies. What's going on today?
What's going on is you've apparently taken an NPR speaking course.
I was going for spooky.
So oh, spooky?
If I was doing NPR, I'd be more like this.
I'd be a little more in this register right here. Well, today we're going to talk about another Studio Ghibli film.
Yes!
So it's gonna be weird.
My Ghiblification continues.
The Ghiblification of the Jononet. Today we're gonna talk about Princess Mononoke.
Nice. Yeah. So what do you want me to be looking at today?
Well, today I think we're gonna talk about hate and how it's bad.
Okay. Good. Some of you haven't learned this lesson.
Hate is bad.
So we're gonna do it again.
You wanna see me do it again?
How do you show love and live in peace when the world around you is not doing that?
Also, you might have an evil arm. I'm just saying.
Okay, that's a different channel.
We don't do that here.
Oof.
Call me your fury! Almighty Lord! Whatever you may be! God or demon, please leave us in peace!
Like, this horrifying thing is happening, and his first response is just like, hey, it's all good, man. Let's just all chill out, yo. Like, it's cool. The demon monster thing is not animated on ones. It's on twos, so every other frame.
Okay.
Unless it's right up close, like when you're swimming through the worms in that shot, that's all on ones.
Okay.
But a lot of the time, there will be random portions of it that are on twos, but they're offset. So like this frame will animate over here, and then this frame will animate over here, and then this frame will animate here. It feels like there's full motion all the time, but the animators don't have to do as much work. It's just really, really smart animation.
Well, I was wondering about that because there's so many individual pieces of that demon.
Oh my gosh. The second I saw that, I was like, three Japanese animators died to make this film for us.
Like, and we honor their sacrifice.
We do.
What I love about Ashitaka, and this is the through line of him throughout the film, is he's exposed to a lot of different moral viewpoints. And I do believe in accepting influence from other people, except when that influence is bad.
Right.
Or better said, when that influence doesn't support you.
Right.
And so Ashitaka listens to everybody, and he takes anything of value that he can find. But the fact is, he kind of lands on, oh, people are apathetic, people don't care, people are burned out, people are full of hate, and I'm not going to be that.
I'm always going to care.
Yeah. And it reminds me of a book you guys have probably read or heard of, The Anatomy of Peace. I just finished reading that. And one of my favorite principles from that book is not letting war into your heart. That there are times when you have to defend yourself physically, but also socially, right? Or emotionally or whatever, that you have to defend yourself. But there's a difference between doing that and hating the person that you are defending yourself against.
Right.
And what I love about Ashitaka is he's not afraid to fight when he has to, but he will always look for the other way. And if he can't, if it comes down to violence or if it comes down to defense, he never does it with hate. And it's always exactly what is necessary.
And no more.
Yeah. And no more. Yeah. Thank you, Factor, for sponsoring this episode. Kitchen Parkour.
Get started on your resolutions with Factor so you can start your new year off right with a sage pork chop.
I've got a cheesy bacon ranch, shredded chicken, herb crusted chicken, tomato goat cheese, cavatappi primavera.
I've also got a turkey chili and zucchini and a three bean vegan chili. Very much looking forward to that.
Ooh, that sounds delicious.
It does sound good.
Factor's ready to eat meal delivery takes the stress out of meal planning and sets you up for success in the new year.
Factor also has more than 35 weekly meal options to choose from.
Suck it, Baskin-Robbins. It's far more than you got.
They have vegan and veggie options, keto, calorie smart, and probably other stuff too, because 35 is a lot.
I get busy with work and I don't have a lot of time between clients. So it's really nice to not have to worry about meal planning, prep, or cleanup. My meal is ready in just 2 minutes.
That means you have 8 minutes left until you see your next client. What do you do with all the time?
Well, I spend about a minute blowing on it and then about 7 minutes delightfully consuming it and moaning.
All of them.
The meals are fresh, never frozen.
And Factored now offers loads of snack options, including breakfast, smoothies, juices, snacks, and more.
That's tasty.
They keep me going no matter what my work schedule looks like.
Head to factor75.com or click the link below and use the code
CINEMA50
to get 50% off your first Factor box. Imagine this full of delicious flavor.
It's a box full of boxes, and the boxes that are in the box are full of food. And food is kind of like little boxes full of energy for your body, which is also kind of like a box.
Why are you here, if you don't mind my asking?
Because I got these sick tats.
I believe you'll recognize this. It shattered the bones of a giant boar, rotted his flesh, and turned him into a monster. I fought with him, and for that I was cursed with this mark on my arm. And soon it will kill me.
Where is it you come from? I've never seen a red elk like that before.
I have come a very long way. I can't tell you more than that.
She's not sorry.
Answer my lady's question or I'll cut you in half!
What do you plan to do? What exactly are you here for?
To see with eyes unclouded by hate.
Eyes unclouded? That explains it. Come, I'll show you all my secrets.
What I think is so cool about him is he, at this point, is quite confident that he's standing before the person responsible for the boar turning into a demon, the forest god turning into a demon, and for his own misfortune that he's got a curse and he's going to die.
Yeah.
And a lot of us, probably me included, would be using this as an opportunity to lay it down. And to get
somehow punish this woman.
Yeah. And he's just looking for solutions. He is just looking for what can we do to restore peace. It is so natural to want revenge, and it's so natural to call that revenge justice. But Ashitaka is such a powerful model of, at every step of the way, he's just like, peace. Peace? You guys want peace? Does anyone want peace?
Everybody gets a
peace.
And it takes a while for the people around him to follow suit.
Well, and the thing I see here is that he says, eyes unclouded by hate, and her response is to laugh.
Yeah.
We come to learn more about her, and she's, you know, actually a good person doing a lot of good things.
Yeah.
But a lot of those cases, she's doing good things for bad reasons. Like, she's saving these women from brothels because she hates brothel owners. She's saving these men from things because she hates where they come, you know.
Her eyes are clouded by hate,
yes.
Right? I think it's curious that she laughs like he's juvenile. Like, what a
silly little baby.
What a quaint idea.
Yeah.
Isaac, you must not have experienced the world. A lot of people who try and live their lives with love experience that. People around him aren't seeing it.
First you steal the boar's forest from him, then transform him into a demon. Now you're making even deadlier weapons. How much more hatred and pain do you think we need?
Yes, I'm the one who shot the boar, and I'm sorry that you suffer. I truly am. That brainless pig. I'm the one he should have put a curse on, not you.
I love his hair bristles when he's bristling. Oop. The arm wants to kill her.
That shot of his hand going around, it's just so kinetic.
Does that right hand of yours wish to kill me now, Ashitaka?
If it would lift the curse, I'd let it tear you apart. But even that wouldn't end the killing now, would it?
No, it wouldn't. It would have to kill all of us to be at peace.
You know what I really like about this movie? It's complex. Yeah. And the people are complex. She is at once apathetic and full of hate. And at the same time, I mean, you talk about doing good, but with eyes clouded by hate. But there's also compassion there.
Yeah.
There's also decency in her.
When she says, I wish that the curse had come on me, not you, I believe her.
Yeah. Yeah. And this is what happens in therapy is... couples therapy, family therapy, people come in and they see the other, right? They see the other as all negative.
Yeah.
As they're the enemy. Or in some cases, that's how they see themselves, as all negative and I'm the enemy. And what I really appreciate about the storytelling is all the characters have layers, all the characters have pain and trauma. Even the terrible things that they do generally comes from a place of pain. The prejudices that they have are not entirely unfounded, but they're also limited,
right?
Yeah. Because the movie sees the diversity, the moral diversity inside each character, but they don't necessarily see that in each other, except for Ashitaka.
Right.
And that's why he's a badass.
Can you hear me, Princess of Beasts? If it's me you want, here I am. If you seek revenge for all the animals we've killed, well, there are two women down here whom I'd like you to meet. They want revenge as well, for husbands killed by your wolves.
Come on out, you little witch! My husband's dead because of you!
Here we are in this place of, you want revenge for the death of the animals, these women want revenge for the death of their husbands, right?
Yeah.
And an eye for an eye leaves the world blind.
The thing that really strikes me in this scene is the shot selection and composition. To stay in that big, big wide with Lady Eboshi and the two affected women, and then when you punch in, it's not like you punch all the way into a close-up, you come into a wide instead of an extreme wide.
Yeah.
It highlights the loneliness and alienation that these women are feeling. It makes the anger feel small.
Yeah.
It's very subtle, it's, you know, it's good filmmaking.
And the distance between them at this point.
Yeah.
Right?
I love that every time he feels mad, a breeze comes up and ruffles his hair and his clothes.
Traitor, you're a spy for the wolves, aren't you?
Sure, buddy.
Stay back. Halt!
Step aside.
This movie has such a beautiful musical score.
It really does.
What do you think you're doing, boy?
Stay your hand. The girl's life is now mine.
I'm sure she'll make a lovely wife for you.
There's a demon inside of you. It's inside both of you. Look, everyone! This is what hatred looks like. This is what it does when it catches hold of you. It's eating me alive, and very soon now it will kill me. Fear and anger only make it grow faster.
I'm getting a little bored of this curse of yours, Ashitaka. Let me just cut the damn thing off.
Lady Eboshi!
Someone come here and take her from me.
Well, there's your mission statement for the film.
Yeah, but it also works because he's talking to the villagers, and so he's being as direct and clear as he can.
Yeah.
Right? He's not trying to win points for subtlety or creativity. He's like, this is, just so you guys know, this is what you're seeing. Mm. And this is a good example of Ashitaka using force without hate.
Yep.
Using force as necessary and only like the exact right amount.
Correct, yep.
Because, yeah, they're going to keep trying to kill each other unless he knocks them out. When I talk about the appropriate use of force, most of us don't get in situations where physical force is necessary. More often, it's about tone and it's about words.
Sure.
And there are definitely times, for example, that I've used a very forceful tone with my children because they were literally clawing and biting and kicking at each other, mm-hmm. right? Now, there's lashing out in anger, and then there's, no, this is what's necessary, because if I say, guys, stop, hey, guys, please don't.
Please don't do that anymore. This is not appropriate behavior. It's like, yeah.
But when a bellowing voice goes, hey! Yeah, exactly. And this is the beautiful thing about force. If you're using it out of anger, you shouldn't be using it.
Right.
In fact, that's with my kids. Like, that's my biggest indicator is, okay, is what I'm about to do or what I just did me being frustrated or angry? Or is it strategic?
Is it strategic to snap them out of something.
And if it's the former, I need to find something else because that's a slippery slope to losing control.
Yep.
And how I know is if I can yell and then immediately drop my voice down and talk calm, that was just a strategic play.
Yeah.
Also, I've had to do that in the therapy office.
This is where you just get a whistle.
I said whistle!
Why can't the humans in the forest live together? Why can't we stop this fighting now?
The humans are gathering for the final battle. The flames of their guns will burn us all.
And what happens to San? What's your plan? Let her die with you?
Typical. selfish. You think like a human. San is my daughter. She is of the wolf tribe. When the forest dies, so does she.
You must set her free. She's not a wolf, she's human.
Silence, boy. How dare you speak to a god like that? I caught her human parents defiling my forest. They threw their baby at my feet as they ran away. Instead of eating her, I raised her as my own. Now, my poor, ugly, beautiful daughter is neither human nor wolf. How could you help her?
I don't know, but at least we might find a way to live.
How? Will you join forces with Sun and fight the humans?
No. All that would do is cause more hatred.
There is nothing you can do, boy. Soon the demon mark will spread and kill you. Now leave this place at sunrise. Return, and I shall kill you.
Speaking of things that work better animated, Wolf Speak, this versus Twilight.
We have to protect the tribe.
It's easier to accept.
It's a lot better.
Yeah.
It's a lot better.
Here's an example of, in conflict, everyone's behavior makes sense to them.
Yeah.
And that is one of the most powerful places to start from in conflict resolution is, okay, why does this position make sense to the person across from me instead of, well, you're just an idiot,
yes.
Right? Or you're crazy, or you're just a jerk, instead of throwing out labels and dismissing and not trying to understand. Because he initially is saying, well, you need to save her and set her free. There's no reason she should die with the forest. And the wolf sees things completely differently. Like, we're all interconnected with the forest. We are the forest, number one, which is kind of beautiful.
It is lovely, yeah.
Number two, something that he's not considering in the moment is, I took her in and raised her and took care of her. I loved her. When humans didn't.
Yeah.
And to Ashitaka's credit, anytime someone makes a valid point, he's like, okay.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, there's not defense of this. There's not pride. There's not ego. He's just, okay, no, that's something I hadn't considered. Thank you, wolf goddess. I say that a lot.
Then one day, Lady Eboshi came along with her warriors and her rifles.
Is this during COVID? What's going on? I love how the gods are all giant animals.
Just giant, huge animals.
What's wrong? Is something hurting your arm?
No, I was just thinking about the boar god.
Yes, something is hurting my arm. I'm angry at all of you dum-dums.
Why did they do all these terrible things? To protect themselves.
Yeah.
To protect their people, to protect their homes. And you can look at that globally, and you can look at that in communities, or you can look at it within the walls of your own home. It's really the same human emotions and the same principles. Just the scale of it changes,
yeah.
Right? And what forms the aggression takes, and what forms the lashing out takes, and what forms the hatred takes, and the fear. It can be small, it can be big, but it's always damaging. Mm. What I like about this, there's a pretty cool, like, Return of the Jedi, Luke Skywalker resisting the darkness within him that keeps trying to pop out with Ashitaka, because it's not just in his arm. You could say, I like how they make his hair bristle, that it's going through his entire body. In his entire soul, and yet he's resisting it for no other reason than he knows better.
It would be really, really easy to hate all the Irontown people, especially Lady Eboshi, if they were doing it to get rich.
Yeah.
If they were, you know, defiling the forest and cutting down all the trees and killing all the animals to get at the iron so that they could get rich. That's not what they're doing.
Yeah.
They're doing it to take care of their own people. Lady Eboshi is not, you know, she's the leader of this town, but she's not some, like, goddess being carried around, you know, and fed fabulous meals. Like, she's working hard.
She's respected, but she's not revered.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And they're under threat from all these other, like, the samurai warlord or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, there's all kinds of stuff. It's complicated.
Yeah.
And it's not just there's a bad person doing a bad thing. It's there's a misguided person doing a bad thing.
Yeah.
And I love seeing layers of complexity like that, where characters aren't just all one thing or the other thing.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's fun to, Darth Vader's all bad. You know, that's also fun.
Except for he wasn't.
Later. But in the beginning.
Yeah, that's fair.
What is it you want?
Lord Asano Samurai have attacked Dyertown! The women are outnumbered! They can't hold them off for long! Forget about the forest spirit! Your men are already heading back to Irontown, but they need
you're too far away.
What proof is there this isn't a lie?
Lie? Don't be ridiculous! What reason do I have to lie?
So it's don't kill the forest gods, now you want us to kill samurai instead?
No! What I want is for the humans in the forest to live in peace!
And then he takes off running.
Bye! I'm done saying my thing now! Ashitaka is such a no-nonsense, like, I'm sure they were not thinking this, but like, coded on the autism spectrum, like, here is the thing that I am thinking, and I have said it, and now I'm gone, bye.
Yeah.
It's just, I love this guy.
It's wonderful.
I love him.
And also, that being the case, what a marvelous protagonist for the autistic community.
Yeah.
Because he's the most moral person in the
Here's
movie.
Here's your moral forest warrior autistic prince. Like,
yeah, and he's you. And he has the emotion of empathy, but a lot of it like is expressed as empathy is the most logical choice.
Yeah.
Kindness is the most logical choice. You guys are gonna, and it's both,
right? Mm-hmm.
But I do really like that about him, because you have characters who are really warm and compassionate in their expression.
Yeah.
And he's not. He's warm and compassionate in the actions that he takes.
Not even with Son, who, like, he's, you know, pretty obviously takes a shine to. He's still kind of like, you are pretty, you know? It's like, yeah.
Oh, yes.
Oh, hey, our wolf god is here.
Your dog looks like it was animated by Ghibli.
Looks like Moro's puppy. Hello.
We see the world through our own lenses.
Yeah.
Our values color how we see the world. And it comes down to, again, why do we do what we do? Because in a conflict, you can lay down arms literally or figuratively, if it's not an actual armed conflict, it's just conflict with a loved one. You can lay down arms really fast if it's not about revenge.
Yeah.
If it's literally just about, I want the most peaceful solution.
Man, that is such an interesting way to think about, like, argument and conflict, like interpersonal stuff, like laying down arms and not taking revenge. I am re-examining many of my life choices.
It's also the reason.
Every decision I've ever made in my entire life has been wrong.
It's also the reason why Ashitaka accepts influence so readily. Because if someone says something that he hasn't considered and it gets them closer to the goal of peace, he's like, okay, it doesn't need to be my way. That's fine.
Yeah.
Right?
Is it more peace? That's it. That's the only thing.
And so that's about setting an intention about what am I really about instead of what am I telling myself I'm about? Because I can justify all sorts of nasty behavior by saying, well, I'm trying to be honest or I'm trying to accomplish peace. But that leads you to ends justify the means thinking instead of, okay, what's going to be the most effective path to get there?
He's searching for his head. We can't stay here. San, you have got to help us.
No! You're on their side. You always were. Take that damn woman and just go away!
San.
Never! I hate all of you humans!
Yes, I'm human, San. And so are you.
Stop it! I'm a wolf, you hear?
San.
Stay back!
I'm sorry. I tried to stop it.
It's over. Everything's over. The forest is dead.
Nothing is over. The two of us are still alive. Now will you help me, son?
I get that in therapy sometimes. You know, Anakin says, if you're not with me, then you're my enemy.
Yeah.
And you get this thing where if you're not siding with one person, they assume, well, then you must be siding
with
the other.
Must be, yeah.
And this is part of the challenge, the invigorating challenge of being a couples therapist, is balancing that.
Two at once.
It's balanced because everybody wants to get theirs, and because everyone's... Yeah. So hurt that they're highly sensitive, and it is honestly, it is super challenging, but that's kind of the thrill of it.
Jonathan Decker, thrill seeker.
No, honestly, it's basically like extreme lugeing,
right? It's the same thing.
Couples therapy. then the way he cuts through it, I love that she lashes out at him, mm-hmm. and he just, he takes it because it's not personal. Mm-hmm. He knows that she may say, I hate you, I hate all humans. What she is really saying is, I'm traumatized and I'm hurting.
Yeah.
And he just comes and he just holds her. And instead of defending himself, he says, that's not true. Which is what a lot of us would do. When she says, you've been on their side from the start, he could say, that's not true. These are all the things that I've done that show I'm on your side. And this is what I'm really about. And instead, he just cuts through and addresses her pain.
Yeah.
And owns that he couldn't stop the disaster that he wanted to stop. And tells her that he's sorry. And instead of telling her that he's on her side, or not on her side as much as that he cares about her, he shows her.
Yeah.
And shows her that he's not siding against her. And he doesn't even have to say the word. She feels it and she releases.
Well, and that's the thing. He shows her, like, I'm not on anyone's side. I'm not on your side. I'm not on the human side. I'm on the side of, let's just make it better.
Yeah.
The great forest spirit is dead now.
Never. He's life itself. He's not dead, son. He's here right now, trying to tell us something. That it's time for both of us to live.
The end goal of any sort of conflict resolution is that, right?
Yeah.
Like, the whole point is, the end goal is not to keep fighting or keep defending. The end goal is, now let's live.
Yeah. He ultimately succeeds in getting everyone to lay down their arms, and it takes as much effort or even more than warring to get people to stop warring.
Yeah.
Right? To get people to lay down arms. And I really love that he's only partially successful.
Yeah.
Right? There are still tensions. Enemies have not become friends or allies.
Right.
They've just understood each other enough to give each other space and room. Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, I'll stop if you stop. Right?
Which, it's such a mature storytelling point of view.
Yeah.
It's not the good guys win and the bad guys are defeated.
Yeah.
It's nobody's all good and nobody's all bad and nobody wins fully and nobody loses fully. It's,
yeah,
we all just kind of get a little bit better.
Yeah. I know people who've gone through really ugly divorces. I know people who've gone through really healthy divorces. And the most people I know who've gone through divorces is like kind of a murky middle of, yeah, we're not really friends.
Right.
But we're no longer enemies.
Right.
Right. And we're gonna live in peace and have this shared goal of peace and for the sake of our kids or what have you. And the way you get even there is by what Ashitaka models the entire film, which is accountability and empathy. I don't have to justify your behaviors and say that they're okay to see that you're a person who's hurting and to see that what you did was motivated largely by that.
Right.
Right? That we all want to feel safe, respected, and loved. And a lot of our worst behaviors come from not feeling safe, respected, and loved, or attempts to get that.
Right. And the poisonous version of that is it turns into hate.
Yeah.
And we assume hate from other people a lot of times when it's not justified.
What Ashitaka does, and each and every one of us can do, is he's a peacemaker. Mm. And that, to me, is the power of this story, is that we can be peacemakers by fostering understanding. And you don't need people to be besties. You can just help them understand each other enough to say, okay, like, you do your thing.
Yep.
I'll do my thing. And that's enough.
So, surprisingly, Studio Ghibli and Miyazaki made another great movie that I really, really liked.
Yeah. Me too. I am loving my Ghiblification.
I'm happy to have Ghiblified you.
That's what she said. Or he said.
I'm glad that you have Ghiblified us, and I'm glad that we have Ghiblified the word Ghibli.
And for those who don't know what I'm talking about, I didn't grow up with these films. And so now I am middle-aged, discovering them for the first time, and they are masterpieces.
They're wonderful, wonderful movies.
So until next time.
What is it you want?
To see with eyes unclouded by hate.
And watch movies.
Gosh, you held that like 2 seconds way too long.
We want to thank our patrons who support us over on our Patreon, and they get a bunch of cool stuff like extended director's cuts. People just like
Skystorm,
Raluca Vladarian,
Jonathan Scolari,
Thomas Foster,
Rixambres Makara.
I'm going to go ahead and guess that that's a made-up name, but if not, your parents rock.
Several of these sound like they could be really incredible Dune characters.
Super awesome Dune characters. Yeah. Evil worms.